Good day, I'm Jim Booker with HorizonRC.com. Today we've got a very popular model with us. This is the E-flite DeHaviland Beaver. Now, John Redman is, of course, the product developer for this, but John's offered to help me through a couple things, that questions that I've heard about and questions that he's heard about, basically with the installation of the tail feathers on the DeHaviland Beaver. So, John, give us a little rundown on what you want to do, and then, of course, we'll go through this thing, and we can show people just exactly how to handle this project.
How you doing, Jim? Well, what we're going to do is we're going to talk a little bit about the tail surfaces right now, or initially, and hinging, and how we do that at the factory, and then maybe what the modeler needs to do when he pulls them out of the box. From there, I want to discuss a little bit about the covering and such there, and then there's been a number of questions regarding a statement in the manual about these neat little guys, which are basically the control arms for the rudder and the tailwheel. And we have made some changes to the kit, and that's probably where the confusion's coming and such, so I'd like to go through all that today.
It looks like, okay, when you install the tail surfaces, all the controls are inside, is that right?
That is correct. It's fully concealed, just like you'd find on a high-quality scale model.
Well, this thing's got some beautiful detail that, you know, is difficult for most modelers to accomplish, but here it is, an almost ready-to-fly airplane with a lot of scale detail on it. The controls mounted inside are always something that I've struggled with in the past. So, where do you want to start with this?
Well, first off, on a lot of our models, what we found is modelers are not interested in hinging flight control surfaces anymore.
Yeah.
I'll be honest, in all the years of my days of modeling, I don't like to hinge either. Coming from the factory, it is quite common for there to be a little bit of residual CA
in the joint,
possibly, or just a little bit of an excessive amount of CA on each hinge, which causes them to be quite stiff in the way they move. What you do is there's a number of things. One, if you take some debonder, CA debonder, mm-hmm. flashback, debonder from Pacer, any of your local brands would be fine. Bob Smith has some great stuff out there. If you don't, believe it or not, nail polish remover works as well.
Really?
Okay. With the nail polish remover, you want to make sure you don't get it on the corrugated surfaces because those are painted, and it potentially might be able to cause some damage to the paint. But if you go in there and you flex the surface and hold it, and then we're going to take a paper towel with some of that debonder and just wipe through there once or twice, and then flip it over and do the same thing. That'll remove any fogging you see in there and loosen stuff up, and then go ahead and flex those surfaces about to the point to where you start to hear something. And make sure you do it and flex them and flex them and flex them
a few times.
And then you'll find they're gonna be quite easy to move. The rudder, the elevator, the ailerons aren't gonna be moving much more than 10 or 12 degrees. You don't need those 3D deflections.
Right, this is not a 3D airplane.
Right, and you'll find on our 3D spun park flyers, we don't hinge the flight control surfaces because trying to maintain a specific tolerance that is required. The factory workers over there, they build airplanes, and keep in mind, they sit down and they're building them quick and fast, and to certain tolerances we found we can't maintain on every production run. So what we do is we show you how we put the knife blade in between the elevator and the stab and put it together, leaving a slight gap, which enables the nice ability for the long 3D throws. So once you have those loosened up and such, of course, on the Beaver, you would you slide the stab in, and you do all your measurements and such. The inner end, once that's done, you pull it out, you cut the covering, and then you're going to glue it in place. And here we heard the push rod sliding. Let me see if I can get stuff in place here. The stab has a hole in it, and that hole is there for this torque rod on the rudder to go down through. So there we go. We're basically stuck in here, and now what we're going to do is we're going to come and we're going to take a look inside the tail. Now, as you can see, the elevator has its own solid steel control horn welded in place on the jointer wire.
Use a regular clevis on
them. And you use a regular clevis on them. And there's the push rod here that I have. It comes and it hooks up here, and that's explained in the manual. Pretty self-explanatory.
Push pull.
In the manual, when the Beaver was initially designed, we had two different control arms. We had one for the tail wheel, we had one for the rudder. And it was based on where the set screw went.
I see. So you have access to it when you install it, yes.
So as we built a few of the early production airplanes for like Ceph and Dogs and a few of the other shows we go to, we sat down and I looked at the CAD drawings again, and what I did is I repositioned a push rod in the fuselage to where now only one type of control arm is required. Okay. It can be used on either side.
So it's less confusing.
But the confusion lies in that the manual has already been printed it states that they are different.
Okay, and then if somebody gets it, it says, right. Well, these are the same, these I've got the right parts.
I have the wrong parts.
Oh, okay.
And it's hard when you manage as many projects as we do here. I mean, I'm doing a large number of projects at any given time. Since I have been here, I have put out, I believe it's close to 25 airplanes. 30 airplanes, and trying to keep up with all of them, I'll tell you, it's tough at times.
Yeah, but you're having fun all the time,
oh,
aren't you, John?
That's right, having fun. Yeah, it's still a job, Jim. So with that, I just want everybody to understand, I will see if I absolutely can get a little bulletin up on the web about these are the same, and I'm hoping this video will help.
We can post it with the product page.
Of course, it drops in here and works right. There's the tailwheel one. It would go in between. Of course, my big sausage
fingers don't. It's like just a lot like a very small nose wheel.
That's correct. And then we have the rudder, which you're supposed to put this on as you drop the rudder through. Now, mind you, I do not have the set screws in these. And it's not all the way up, it's just fallen down a little bit. But the push rods are designed now to where the same piece will work for all three.
I see.
And such. So no longer is there a separate one for each one. They're the same. So
it should make it easier.
I believe so. So now people would sit down and wonder, why don't you just go back and change the manual? The manual being 65 to 75 pages long, it'll change outline features and such, and layout procedures. The end result is we almost have to redo the entire manual. And to do an instruction manual for one of these airplanes, the amount of resources, the amount of time, which equals a whole lot of dollars. Once a product is out, it's very difficult to go back and invest almost another substantial amount of money. It's a four-digit figure that's quite steep.
Well, John, I've got another perspective on that thing, too. This airplane has been somewhat difficult to get in any respect, and I can just hear the screams if we were to hold up shipping the airplane.
To do a new manual.
To do a new manual right now.
And so. I can tell you that everyone can blame me for it being hard. It's all my fault. When we initially elected to do the Beaver, I'll be honest, I'm an old military guy. And I'm a fighter guy, and if it doesn't kill somebody, it's just not really a whole lot of excitement to me. But I have to say, when they said, do the Beaver, we got the first sample, I'm looking, I said, well, it's not a bad looking airplane. You guys really think this is going to sell well? And we'll just say I was tar and feathered pretty hard. And the end result is it has been one of the hottest selling airplanes E-flite has ever done. And it continues to stay there. And it's hard. It's not an easy airplane to produce at the factory. It takes time. You know, we can't spit 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 of these out in a couple weeks. There's a lot of work that goes into them before they hit the box and hit the shores.